Hi everyone, this is Balash from RacingBrick. This is my third video exploring the possibilities of 3D printing in the LEGO world. If you missed the previous videos, then click on the link in the top right corner. A couple of words if you are new to this series. No, this is not a 3D printer review. You can see machines here provided by manufacturers or retailers, but they are simply used to experiment with LEGO. I am no expert, I'm sure you can see things in these videos that can be done better. We are here to have fun and to expand the boundaries of the hobby and see how new technologies can be used with LEGO. Today we are going to try to radically improve the look of this Batmobile from this to this, and that requires some flexibility, so let's get started. You could already see last week the printer we are going to use today, the Artillery Genius Pro. The Flashforge in the previous videos is a good printer with some useful extra features, but you wanted to see something with a much nicer price tag, and I needed a machine with a direct extruder for today's experiments. So that's how the Artillery printer has arrived, everything is neatly packed. Assembly was definitely more difficult than the Flashforge, but with a few YouTube videos watched in advance, it was done in about 30 minutes. This included gluing this little part that was trying to escape in the box, not an uncommon scenario as we saw. We made the necessary adjustments, and the printer was ready to go. The machine has a 22x22x25cm build volume and a volcano nozzle with a maximum temperature of 240 degrees Celsius. It has a dual Z-axis design with double screw drive motors and an AC-powered fast-heating tempered glass printing platform. Personally, I prefer flexible plates because it's easier to remove objects from them, so we'll see how this one works. There is no wireless connectivity, just the good old USB port and an SD card slot. It has a graphical touchscreen with a fairly simple menu, but it does the job. Printing is super silent compared to the Flashforge Adventurer 4, you can hear the difference clearly. If you want to know more technical details about the Artillery Genius Pro printer, I recommend to click on the link in the description. I made a couple of PLA prints and they worked well. Here is this vase I printed for the LEGO flowers using this color-changing filament. Now here's a little riddle for you. I didn't do most of the heavy lifting myself regarding this project, but my partner in crime didn't want to be revealed in the video, so here's a print that might give you a clue if you are a black belt consumer of custom Technic vehicle videos. Many thanks to Mr. Master of Connectors for the support. But that's not the main topic today. I needed a direct extruder printer because I wanted to use TPU. If you are not familiar with this type of filament, it's much more flexible than PLA, and there are many different kinds, but this one is really soft and stretchy. And why do we need TPU? Because we want to print LEGO tires. You might be wondering why, since there are tons of different types and sizes, but the truth is that there is nowhere near enough choice and there are many cases where the right size or type isn't available. Here is this Technic Batmobile. I like the overall look and functionality with the light up bricks, but there is one thing that ruins the game for me, the wheels. Interestingly, their size in general is good compared to the body. Here is a reference picture from the designer of the movie vehicle. The problem is the proportions of the tires and the rims. The tires of the LEGO version are too thin and the rims are too big, while the original car in the movie has fat tires both in the front and in the back. As we checked, the rims of the front wheels are more or less okay for the rear ones, but for the front ones we needed some custom rims to be printed. We had no experience with TPU, so here is our journey. We first decided to use this FiberFlex 30D filament and started with some basic testing. Here are the first prints we made to test the basic shaping and flexibility of the material. One thing stands out right away, the material is unfortunately too shiny compared to normal rubber used by LEGO. Flexibility is fine, actually it seems to be too flexible when the walls are thin and there is no support inside at all. This was the first attempt with patterns on the surface. Then for the sake of science we had to cut this LEGO tire in half to see how it's built and what the profile looks like. These smaller tractor tires were made to test different tread designs and see how sturdy they are. This is a scaled up version that might be a good starting point for off-roading, but we are not there yet. Then came this monster as a test. I downloaded a file from Thingiverse to see how a real tire could be printed. It took more than 24 hours to print and used tons of filament. Just look at the weight of the tire and also check how much support we had to add to print it. The end result is huge and impressive, it even sounds like a rear tire. But the finish and look on the sides could be nicer, and honestly I don't think this is the most economical way to make such massive tires. Fortunately, LEGO builds rarely need these huge beasts, so it was time to downsize. The profile was surgically removed from the giant and adapted to a smaller scale. I think this was the point where we were really unhappy with the super shiny surface of this filament. We tried many different methods to get rid of it, heat gun, sanding, dirt, but nothing really worked. So we decided to go with another filament that promises a matte finish in its very name, the MatteFlex 40D. 30D on the previous filament and 40D on this one indicates shore hardness, a scale used to measure the resistance of different materials. The higher the number, the higher the hardness, which means that the matte filament is slightly less flexible than the glossy one. This one has the support still in there, by the way, which we found useful to hold the shape, but if I remove it, you can still see the difference between the two materials. I don't really feel much difference between the grip, but the more flexible, shiny one seems to have a bit more resistance. The thread pattern definitely helps here. If you look at the early sleek versions, it has almost no resistance on any surface, so it's nowhere near as sticky as a regular rubber tire. After all this experimentation, we finally focused on the Batmobile. You can see the profile of the original tires we tried to recreate. The tread on this first version wasn't yet so deep and not very visible, and here are the final versions. I also printed the larger wheels with the first glossy material. You can clearly see why we didn't want to go with that one. The stiffer material had some true challenges here. Even with the softer one, it was quite a challenge to put the tire on the rims. Oh, and the rims weren't actually wide enough to have the right proportions, so these extension rings had to be printed for them. The rim design for the smaller wheel was totally experimental, but I think it looks pretty good. Unfortunately, it's completely obscured by the Lego parts of the Batmobile. This time the larger ones fit the smaller rims, and I think the end result makes a huge difference in the look and feel of the car. The front wheel arches are still very off, but I think this design fits the original concept much better. So, why didn't we get it from Lego then? Well, as you can see, this single set would have required two new tires and one new rim design, which unfortunately we won't get for a $100 set. But luckily we have a 3D printer that we can use to significantly improve the look. Now I know what you all want to know. The looks are good, now let's see how it rolls. I mean, it looks like rubber, but what about practical performance? This is a quick and non-scientific test with this buggy converted to an XL motor and the differential removed. Here are the three tires with the same diameter and width. This is the stock rear tire of the Batmobile. This is the more flexible but shiny print. And here is the less flexible matte print. As you can see in the comparison on the carpet, the shiny print has a visible advantage. It doesn't slide back like the Lego tire. I think the tread pattern helps on the carpet to stay in place. The matte version can't really go up at all. If we turn the board to the wooden side, you can see the disadvantage of the shiny print. Despite the tread pattern, the surface isn't as sticky as the Lego tire, so it can't go up at all. Based on this, I think the softer material might be useful for the tires, but more like for the off-road ones, where the grip depends less on the stickiness of the material and more on the pattern and depth of the tread. So folks, as you see, it is definitely possible to print tires for Lego vehicles, although there are a few compromises. There is still a long way to go before we can print proper off-road tires. That would be the ultimate goal, of course, but it should be definitely possible. This filament would be the best from a flexibility standpoint in my opinion, but this one looks much better. If you know any affordable filaments that have both of these qualities, please let me know in the comment section. There is one more option that we will definitely explore in the future, using flexible resin. I'm starting to experiment with resin printing soon, and I would like to test some promising flexible resins in addition to ABS-like Lego-compatible pieces. Again, if you have any experiences or suggestions, please share them in the comments. If you like this video, then please give it a thumbs up, and don't forget to subscribe with notifications, as more exciting Lego videos are coming soon. See you next time, bye bye!